take the title off him on the 24th, and
how?
I just call him whatever comes to mind. You got a lot of names for him.
You will take it. You be there in the Cleveland Arena this month, the 24th, or what is it, March? And you will see what you take.
Now, I know what you're going to take. You're going to take a beat.
You don't have a chance. There ain't nowhere in the world you can whoop me.
Oh,
I'm going to sweep the ring up with you.
Yeah,
I'm going to clean up the ring with you right here on television. I want the whole world to see it. I'm the true champ of the world. Joe Frazier, Kid Jock Norton, Coleman, all of them. Ain't nobody going to whoop me.
You're the talking champ.
Yeah, you think I'm just talking, huh?
It's hard to talk.
You think I'm just talking, huh? And a glove in my mouth.
Yeah, right. It'd be hard to talk.
I'll put my right
in
my mouth just for that. You are trying to set it and be cool. You agitate.
I'm not Howard Cosell. I didn't agitate. I asked a man a simple question.
He was going to be on the show.
What?
I mean, Howard Cosell gets paid for being an idiot. What's your excuse?
Just fighting Muhammad Ali and just getting to that point in your life. If you could just share, what was it like having the chance? Because at one point, correct me if I'm wrong, it was George Foreman you were going to fight, but Muhammad Ali beat him in the eighth round, and then you're like, oh my God, my chances are gone. So take me from that point. Where was it that you actually knew that Don King was going to help you and get that chance to fight Muhammad Ali?
Well, we were ranked eighth in the world, and we took on a new promoter, Don King. And he had been an old friend of my manager, Al Braverman, for many years ago in Las Vegas. And Don said, look, I'm gonna try to get you a shot at the title, but first you have to go out to Salt Lake City, Utah, and fight this guy, Terrible Terry Hinkey. They call him the Stormin' Mormon. Big puncher, knocking everybody out. And he said, if you beat him, we'll get you a shot at George Foreman, or at least we'll try. I said, okay. So they sent me out to Salt Lake City, Utah, and I had already won the North American and the National Americas Heavyweight Championship, beating Ernie Terrell in Atlantic City.
And Chuck, at this time, champ, were you training, or you were working in training? I mean, when you fought Hinkey, how was the training at this point in time?
I was working in training. I never trained full-time for a fight except for Muhammad Ali. I was a part-time fighter, you might say. I was never subsidized. A lot of guys get to break where they get an organization behind them and they get paid to do nothing but train. I never had that that thing. So I used to get up in the morning, do my road work, and go to work all day. And then at home, I run home, eat dinner, go to the gym, train, and come home and go to sleep, and then do the same thing all over again each day. And it was hard.
And this is before Salt Lake City. You went to fight.
Right.
Terrible.
And I was doing that for all my pro fights before then. Now I was ranked eighth in the world. I got ranked in the top 10. And King sent me out to Salt Lake City, Utah. And I fought Hinkey, and I knocked him out in the 11th round. I had him down 7 times. Tough guy, big puncher. But I just wore him down like I do most of the guys, because I was never a great fighter. I was just a tough guy who was in great shape.
You played basketball all your life, right?
Right. I was a big basketball player. I played a lot of basketball, and I was a conditioned guy. And that helped me in win most of my fights.
And being with stamina.
I outgutted the guys, and that's how I won most of my fights. Anyway, I come home, and I'm all excited because now I'm looking to fight George Foreman. He's going to fight Ali, and everybody figured he was going to walk right through Ali because Ali, had been laid off for a while, hadn't been fighting. Anyway, lo and behold, Muhammad Ali knocks out George Foreman in the 8th round.
Right.
Big upset. And I do believe this. I was supposed to get a shot at Foreman, and now I'm out of the title picture. Anyway, Don King called me up and said to me, Chuck, I promised you a shot at the title. You're going to fight Muhammad Ali.
And what year we're talking?
That was 1974. The end of 74. Anyway, 3 months and a day later, I got a phone call from Don King.
You were watching you were watching TV at the time, right? Did your mom call you, and how'd that go?
Anyway, I was at home watching TV, watching Telly Savalas. I love Telly Savalas.
Right, right.
My friend, I used to watch Kojak.
Right.
I usually don't even answer the phone when Telly Savalas.
Right, right.
In them days, he was on 11 to 11:30 at night. Anyway, I just had a premonition. I jump up, I answer the phone, and it's my mother. And she says, Chuck, 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 did you see the papers? I said, no, Mom, I didn't see the paper, and I told you never to call me when Kojak is on. She said, don't be a wise guy. She said, go up and get the papers. I said, what does it say, Mom? She said, the whole back page of the New York News says, Ali to defend against what, the March 24th at Richfield.
Wow.
Anyway, I'm all excited. I run up to the theater where they're selling the papers, and the truck is just pulling away, and I almost cut the truck off. You know, I said, you got any papers left this year? We got about three, Chuck. So I said, give me, I'll take all three of them. Sure enough, the back page of the New York.
You still have them?
Yep, Ali defend against Webster, March 24th in Richfield, Ohio. Needless to say, it was great. And I started getting phone calls the very next morning. Don King called and said, we're going to send you up to camp. You're going to go to camp the first time and only time in my life.
Right.
And they sent me up to the Granite Hotel up at Kyabishka Lake, New York.
Did you have a trainer?
I had a guy named Don Bufano. He was actually the guy, the manager of the gym. He was, Don was close to 90 then. And I never had a full-time trainer. Any guy who was working in the gym used to help me train. And Al Braman called me and said, Chuck, I'm going to get a couple of guys from New York, a couple of real pros. One guy will be like your trainer, the other guy's not waiting at all. Dominic Bufano has been my trainer for the last 3 or 4 years. I'm taking him up to camp. And Al says, Chuck, I got a guy named Patty Flood. This guy's worked with some of the best guys. Look, you can bring Patty if you want. I like Patty. But Dominic Bufano's coming up. He never got a shot at anything big in his life. Now he's going up for the world championship. I brought him up. And I had my sparring partners. I brought them up.
And your cut man.
And my cut man was Al Braman.
Right.
Who was also my manager. And I got a shot at the title. I was a 40-1 underdog, not to win the fight, a 20-1 underdog, not to go 5 rounds.
At that point, when you had this was an opportunity, what was going through your mind at this point in time? Just how to train, or were you saying to yourself, I'm fighting Muhammad Ali? How did it register to you to either keep focused on training, or just the whole, in light of your boxing career, you could win this?
Yep. The reason I had so much, I always had confidence anyway. You know, some guys say they're scared going to the fight. I was never scared going to the fight. The only thing I was scared about was not doing good.
Right.
Not looking good. You know, I always knew I was in terrific shape. And I figured maybe Ali would take this fight lightly, you know, after the tough fight with Foreman. And, you know, I'd be in great shape, trained full-time for the first and only time in my career. And I would have a chance of beating him. And as a matter of fact, I was so confident that the night before the title fight,
I love this story.
I bought my wife a powder blue negligee and I gave it to her. And I said, honey, I want you to wear this negligee to bed tonight, because tonight you're going to be sleeping with the heavyweight champion of the world.
Wow.
Anyway, as you know, I didn't win the fight. And after the fight, I come back to the hotel room. And she's in the bedroom sitting on the edge of the bed. She says, she's wearing the negligee now. And she said to me, am I going to Ali's room, or is he coming to mine? Very funny. Anyway, it didn't work out the way I wanted. But like Howard Cosell said later on, that Chuck Webster gained more in a losing effort than Ali did in the win. Because nobody expected me to go more than 5 or 6 rounds. I thought I'd get cut up. And I was in great shape.
During the fight, I mean, the first round, I watched the fight. I watched it 4 or 5 times. And you probably know this, maybe you don't know this, but did you know you're the only boxer ever to knock Muhammad Ali down with a right hand?
I know, I'm the only boxer ever to knock Muhammad Ali down when he was world champion. He was down twice the contender, Cooper and Frazier. He was the contender then. Now he was champion of the world. It's the only time he was ever down as champion of the world, and I had him down in the 9th round.
With a right body
shot.
Yeah,
right, good shot. You know, I felt it all the way up to my shoulder. I hit him on the right hand under the heart. He was off balance, pulling away from the jab, but it was a definite knockdown. When you watch the fight with the sound, you can actually hear the thud of the punch, you know. And Ali said later on that I hit him and it was a knockdown. You know, they made up a story about the foot.
The foot, you tripped.
Any time in the fight.
There was one point in the fight where your knee came up and it looked like you tried to trip him, and then he complained about that. Then you tapped gloves.
I tried to kick him.
You tried to kick him?
I tried to kick him. Yeah. He hit me with jabs and moving. I just tried to kick him. I got a little frustrated, you know. I got news for you. A lot of guys get frustrated fighting Muhammad Ali. He's probably one of the two or three greatest fighters that ever lived. And I just couldn't catch him. And you know what people don't realize about Ali? He takes a great punch. He's never been knocked out. Got stopped by Larry Holmes, and that's the only time, you know. And he takes a great punch. It's very hard to hit him with two in a row. And he's a very, very skilled fighter.
Yeah. Well, I mean, when I looked at you and Sonny Liston, I mean, talk about a jaw. I mean, champ, I'm beside myself at how you can take that much pain and still stand. And I think at one point in the fight, the referee had said, "How many fingers do I have?" But your comment was, "How many guesses do I get?"
That's right. That was Barney Felix.
Yeah.
He wanted to stop the fight. He asked me, my manager had his hand on my back. He tapped me three times because everything was blurred to me. But I knew there was only one round left, and I wanted to finish the fight. And they let me come out for the 10th round. And the doctor, halfway through the 10th round, jumped up on a ring apron and stopped the fight.
Just the cut, was it on your left eye?
Yeah. Well, both eyes were cut, but the left eye was the bad one.
Wow.
I had 338 stitches. I had more than anybody else that ever fought, except for Vito Antifermo. He had 329.
How do you absorb the punch and still stand up? What made you?
Well, I've been lucky. You know, I've always been able to take a great punch. I have great bone structure. In them days, I had a 20 and a half inch neck. I have about a 19 now. A long time ago. But I could just take a punch. You know, there's some guys that can punch natural punches, and then there are other guys that could take a punch. And I could take a punch. You know, I had half my fights, a little better than half my fights by knockout. But that's not a great percentage. Sonny Liston, I think, had the greatest knockout proportion and form and guys like that. But I just was able to have a mindset when I got in the ring that I was not going to be knocked out or down. And boy, I got hit with some shots.
I bet you have.
I saw some fights, man, I'll tell you.
Well, what was your nickname at the time? It was the Bayonne Bleeder, right?
Well, I got that name. Rosie Rosenberg, the editor of the Bayonne Times, was there the night I fought Liston. And when I was getting hit with punches, I was spraying blood all over the arena. And it got on his tan leisure suit. And he said, "Jesus Christ, look at this blood." They ought to call this guy the Bayonne Bleeder. And the name stuck.
Something else.
As a matter of fact, that's going to be the name of the movie when it comes out. The
Is
Bleeder.
That right?
Yeah. The Bleeder. And I have a letter out on my desk now about a guy named Mike Kunda, who's writing a book about me now as we speak. And he's toying with the name of the book, The Bleeder.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's...
You know, you take a lot of pride and you stuck by, you know, where you were born and raised. And, you know, Everlast wanted to pay you $5,000 at one point in time to put Everlast in the back of your...
They wanted to put Everlast on the back of my robe and I... No.
Yeah,
I
you said forget Bayonne, that.
I had New Jersey on the back of the robe. That was it. And in them days, $5,000 was a lot of money.
It sure
was. 38, 39 years ago. And I've always been proud of being from Bayonne.
So when you were fighting Muhammad Ali and you knocked him down with that
right.
heck of a right to his body,
right?
He fell down.
Well, he didn't fell. He got knocked down. I went back to the corner and I said to my manager, Al Braben, "Al, start the car. We're going to the bank with millionaires." And Al said to me, "Chuck, you better turn around. He's getting up and he looks pissed off." I said, "Uh-oh."
In round number nine, the early
the bell rang for round nine, and I went out from the corner just like I always did. Finally, about halfway through the round, he threw a big jab, and I slipped under it and threw that big right hand right under the heart.
His left. Oh, a vicious shot to the rib of Muhammad Ali, and what a surprise! Chuck Wessner gets to the body of Muhammad Ali. Now let's see what happens here. We're going to count it to six, seven.
Chuck hit him with a body shot and knocked him down.
Ali, vicious right hand.
And I said, oh, my God, Chuck's going to be the champion of the world.
Everybody was yelling, keep him down, Chuck, keep him down.
In round 9, when Chuck knocked him down, I think everybody in the audience was, the fans, were like just in shock.
The whole crowd changed. It was like the little guy's got a chance.
Don't forget, in the history of Muhammad Ali, this was his third time only after so many fights that he got knocked down.
I mean, he's the greatest in the world, just gets flattened by the Bayonne bleeder. How embarrassing is that?
And he picked it up a notch because Drew Bundini Brown started screaming at him. The hell is wrong with you? This guy's kicking your ass, this whitey mother. You know, that's the kind of language Drew used. And go after him. And he picked it up. And in the last
Was it just in the first 5-6 rounds? What was Muhammad Ali doing?
He was moving jab and doing rope-a-dope, and that's what he does. He even did it with Foreman. And then he opened up on Foreman and hit him with a couple of combinations and knocked him out. But he was he was figuring on winning the fight with jabs and right hands if he had the opportunity. But Bundini Brown and his manager at that time, who was my dear friend, too, he just passed away.
Is Angelo?
Angelo Dundee. Come on, Jim, pick it up, come on. And he did. He picked it up, and that's why he's such a great fighter. You know,
He said he didn't have to train as hard, but he did train.
He trained. You don't go 15 rounds with somebody chasing you, because I made the fight. I was pressing him the whole time.
You were? You were calling him on at points
of time. Yeah, I called him on a couple of times, and he was saying stuff to me, too, you know, and you whitey mother. I mean, you know, that's the way he talks.
Yeah.
Come on, show me what you got, you whitey man. You know, and but that's just his... That's why he was the greatest promoter that ever lived.
Yeah, he's self-promoting,
yeah,
he wasn't
he? He's self-promoted himself, and he, you know, him and I now are such good friends. I was at his birthday party in Las Vegas. They flew me, Foreman, Norton, Spinks, all the guys, Shivalo, all the guys who fought him out to Las Vegas for his 70th birthday.
Wow.
And it was awesome. We were there for 3 days, and they had 2,100 people at $7,500 a ticket.
Wow.
He had De Niro, Pacino, the Kiss, the Stones. He had everybody out there. And
you have a good time?
I had a great time. Because, you know, he was supposed to be there Friday, and he went to Whitney Houston's wake. So he didn't come Friday. But they had a big private party. Jimmy Brown, the running back from Cleveland, and his birthday are the same, and a good friend. We went to that party. And then the next morning, May and Hannah, two of his daughters, came and got me and said, come on, come on, come on, Uncle Jack. They called me Uncle Jack. Daddy's here, he wants to see. And I went up, I saw him. And I gave him one of my business cards. You know, I got a couple of things I got to show you.
Sure.
One of my business cards, on the back of it, oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
On the back of it, it has Muhammad Ali down. You know, and naturally, that's one of my claims to fame. Champion 12-round decision, Atlantic City. Well, you know what they usually do is just use one over here and one over the other shoulder. I don't wear my glasses. I'm 50 years old. That's the New York and National Gold Gloves Championship
medal.
All gold with a diamond in it. And this is the AAU Championship medal I won the same year.
And you served in the United States Marine Corps.
Oh, yeah, sure. 56 to 59.
Here, this is better.
And then, here's one picture. That was the 12th, 13th. It was late in the fight. You can see I had some cuts over the eyes.
And the swelling, too. Just.
Yeah. Yep. So these are things, most guys sold these away, lose mm-hmm. them, they sell them,
they
championship,
need the money.
But they need the money. Another story, we go to, over to New York to the big, which you can just put it there, we go to New York to the big auction place, Sotheby's, and I go over there with my lawyer, Tony Fusco, And he says, you're going to come over there with me because Willie Pep's over there selling his championship belt. So we go over there. Sure enough, Willie Pep sells his belt. So I said to my lawyer, who's very wealthy anyway, I said to him, you ought to buy those belts, and then we'll give them back to him. That'd be great publicity for your firm and for you.
Got it all.
So what is this, Champ?
That's myself, Floyd Patterson, Carlos Ortiz, Jake LaMotta, Willie Pep, Carmen Basilio, Emil Griffith, Joe Giardello, Muhammad Ali.
Allies Cole.
Allies Cole, and that's Buddy McGirt in the other left corner.
Wow.
Yeah, all world champions.
Marciano's gym.
The only guy who wasn't there, we just fixed, was Muhammad Ali. Everybody else was there. I had to pay $1,500 a piece that
Wow.
night, which is 38 years, 37 years ago, down Atlantic City.
Champ, what's that saying on his hands?
It says, to Chuck and Linda, good luck to my good friends. Chuck and Linda, good luck to my good friend, Muhammad Ali. P.S. Stay off my foot. Now it's faded over the years, but...
Well, what did Ali say that how you hit him? You hit him with a left foot? Oh, he's hysterical.
A right hand and a left foot. Well, I did hit him a left foot because I kicked him once.
You kicked him once,
he
right.
He said to me, basically, your rabbit punched me, you kicked me, everything else. I have probably over 100 trophies. That's a real
one. Yeah, these are all some
messy. He's a Hall of Fame award.
I don't know if you want to take a picture of this.
You saw that.
Yes, Sports Illustrated.
This Chuck's father. I don't know.
That's what drives you.
That's right. I want to win at everything. Basketball, softball. I played all sports. And football, we used to play touch football. And I would have to say that boxing was my...
You know, looking at boxing today, and I have a bunch of questions, and you know, your role model growing up when you were just a kid, and your favorite movies growing up to start molding you, and what brought you to boxing? Your brawler growing up, of course, you know, the Ali fights that you were in, and nobody could touch you in the alley. And I think Muhammad Ali even said that at one point.
Yeah, he said, fight him in the ring, run to this guy in an alley. Yeah.
Right. So did you choose boxing, or did boxing choose you?
You know, my father was a fighter. My father was a professional fighter. And he was not a big name. I think he had a 4-11 record, but he was the kind of guy who hung out in the gyms and sparred. But he sparred with Dempsey, he sparred with Jimmy Braddock. He sparred with a lot of the guys, and they would call him at the last minute if they needed a fill-in or something, you know. But I like boxing because I like fighting, because it was a one-man sport. You didn't have to depend on anybody else, like in football, basketball, baseball. Joe Barisi, who was the head trainer for the PAL, I was working in a bar here in Bayonne, Mater's Rendezvous. It was a go-go bar, the one and only go-go bar ever in Bayonne. They wound up closing them down. But I was working the door, and I had a couple of fights at the door. We get drunks and all. And Joe Barisi came up one day, the coach of the Bayonne PAL, and asked me, he said, look, you got pretty good hands. You're a big guy. We need a heavyweight for the PAL boxing team. We're going into the New York Golden Gloves, which is the big one. That's the whole East Coast. Jersey Gloves is nice, but the New York Golden Gloves is the big one. There's over 300 contestants in there. Anyway, I trained for 2.5 months.
You did?
And one of the coaches down there didn't even want to let him put me in a tournament. He said, look, Chuck, trained for 2.5 months. You know, he's not ready. He's not ready for that type of competition. And I said, yeah, but I want to give it a try. And he said, nah, I don't think so. But Joe Barisi, who was the head coach, said, you know what, he trained down here. We don't have any other heavyweights. Let's put him in. So they put me in and another guy named Marshall Palmley. At the last minute, they put him in, who had been training for a long time, pretty good fighter. Anyway, Marshall got beat in the second fight. I won 5 straight. And I won the New York and East Coast Golden Glove Championship in Madison Square Garden. And as a matter of fact, the title fight against a guy named John O'Sullivan is the first time I ever met my father.
Really?
My mother and father were separated when I was a year and a half old. My mother moved to Bayonne and she raised us. And my father had a restraining order against him because they had some problems. So he stayed in New York and eventually moved to Florida and got remarried. And the way he found out that I was fighting in the Golden Gloves was he's sitting there having breakfast 2 days before the Golden Gloves finals in Madison Square Garden, and they print on the back of the news, because it was the New York Daily News Golden Glove, the picture of all the finalists. And one of the guys said, his name is Charlie Webner, he said, there's a picture of a kid here named Charles Webner fighting for the championship, the heavyweight championship of the Golden Glove. Any relation to you? And my father looked and said, geez, you believe it? That's my son. He said, I got to go up there. So he jumped on a plane, got a reservation, flew up, and a half an hour before the bout, he walked into my dressing room and said, you know who I am? I said, sure, I know you are, Dad. I understood. You know, my mother
and
never
how old,
said...
how old were you at that time?
25.
All right, continue.
My mother never said anything bad about him, never. Just said, you know, we had problems, and it was best that we split up, and... Anyway, he was there for the fight, and it's funny because there was 18,210 people in the garden that night, the old garden, and like my father said, he said, you know, 16,000 of them are probably cops, because he said, you know, you're fighting a cop. I was fighting a sergeant of the New York Police Department, and they called him Big John Sullivan, and he's a big Irish guy, and anyway, he was there for the fight, and I won the championship, and...
Jeez.
You know, the rest continued from there. The following year, I signed the contract, the 5-year contract, and I started fighting professionally. And
now,
I did pretty good.
Yeah, what, 35, 14, and 2, right?
Is that 30, well, there's two wins there in Boston that they never even put in the book. But 35, 14, and 2. And I had an argument with them, and they insisted that was the record. So, yeah, that's okay.
It's okay, so it's really 37.
I thought it was 37, yeah, but that's all right. They left out two names on it.
Two names, what, any reason why?
Yeah, because they didn't keep good records 50 years ago. You know, like, when I started in 1965, 75, 85, 95, 205, 215, 50 years ago almost.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's, and I'll tell you something else, they had smaller gloves, they had 8-ounce gloves,
now
they had 10,
right.
You know, and
15 rounds,
the referees, yeah, it was 15 rounds, now it's 12. They, a lot of things changed.
They sure
and,
did.
And in them days, too, the referee was the sole judge in some of the fights, all according to what state you fought in.
Yeah.
You know, and everything, a lot of things changed, and it's, I guess they changed for the better.
How do you like it today compared to boxing today, where we don't have a champ in the U.S. and boxing has really taken a dive?
Yeah, we don't have a heavyweight champion.
We don't have a heavyweight champion.
Because there's no heavyweights, no good heavyweights. The Klitschko brothers have ruled it 12 years or something now, and I'll tell you something, Vitaly Klitschko, I think it's Vitaly holding the world title. He's a tough guy, very good fighter, and he could do good in any era. But we don't have anybody to challenge him. So he just fights more or less who's ever available, and he usually knocks him out. And what are you going to do? You know, the smaller division, the smaller guys, the welterweights, the lightweights, those guys, they've got some good bouts. But even though most of them are won by, you know, people from out of this country.
Yeah. Well, now that, I mean, how do you feel about these fights now, the martial arts fighting, in
MMA.
The cage, MMA, how do you
know,
see
it,
that?
You know, it's funny, but...
do you watch it?
I do watch it. I do watch it once in a while, and it's brutal, but you know what? I studied and I trained in my black belt. I'm a black belt in Ishiru Karate, so... it's called Michibudaro, which is the art of ground fighting. I specifically took up that type of karate and ground fighting with some holds and all because I knew these guys don't box you. They look to take you down, take you to the mat, make you submit. So it's a different type of fighting, and I think it's very brutal, personally. They use a little striking gloves, and you look at some of these guys have 10, 12 fights. They have cauliflower ears, broken noses. You know, not for nothing, but I had a lot of fights, and I don't have a cauliflower ear or a broken nose.
That's incredible because
of the gloves. Yeah, it's a brutal sport, but it's very popular.
It is.
Yes.
Getting back to Muhammad Ali, and I like this. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I'm going to show you something too. Also, a guy produced a book here. He went out, and 7 years or so. He interviewed over 700 guys, and the book is called Tough Guys, 50 of the Toughest Guys in the World, and I made the cover.
Wow.
I made the cover in the book. There. I'll show it to you later on. It's a
all
great
right.
shot.
Yeah, we'll
and I know
some.
A lot of the guys in the book, and almost every one of them is an MMA-type fighter, which is karate, jiu-jitsu. That's where I have my black belt in, karate, jiu-jitsu, and Taifu, which is a type of karate that's a killing form, just like jiu-jitsu. Karate is a striking form. Jiu-jitsu is the killing form of karate.
Yeah.
And my sensei who trained me, Vincent Marchetti, is a 10th degree red belt. There's only one of them in the world now.
What year were we talking when you were doing?
When I was doing that, I was doing when I was 52 years old. So that had to be 23 years ago.
Jeez. So you're still training. You're still in shape.
Yeah, I go to the gym. I'm not even going to the gym today. I'll be in the gym today after I get done. And you got to do something.
You have to.
You
body in motion stays in motion, right?
Yep, exactly.
So
right.
Talk to me very quickly about, you had mentioned in some articles that some you listed, his punch, his
hardest.
Did he hit the hardest in your career?
He hit the hardest.
He did.
Oh yeah,
he
had everything short, and he didn't wing anything. George Foreman, when I fought him, was a swinger. He was a young guy. I fought George before he became a good puncher. So when he came back the second time, he was a short puncher, and everything was a snap, much better fighter. But Sonny Liston had a jab and a left hook that he could punch through a wall. He could really hit.
Really?
72 stitches I got in that fight total.
Chuck, I think I'm repeating myself here, but I had to do it all over again. You still stick to boxing, you still
yeah.
do it, but you would have it more subsidized. You would actually have the coach, you would have the money to
right.
train. And it's amazing when I look at the fights, and as you, in retrospect, look at all the fights, if he had the time to train and dedicated to the training, if he went 15 rounds Muhammad Ali, with only 3 months of training, can you imagine if he had 6 months of training?
Exactly.
9 months of training.
Yep.
And real coaching and a support team.
It would have been,
It would have been a different story. No wonder Sylvester Stallone saw this as an opportunity of taking this and making a movie out of it, because your life is really, truly one of a kind. Who comes close to what you've done?
I think probably a lot of guys have done, gone a lot further than I expected in my training. But in my case, my life, I think, has been very colorful. And that's why 38, 39 years later, people are still doing TV and doing interviews with me. Like I told you a couple of stories about the negligee and this
yes.
and that. And I'm still pretty literate, and I give a good interview. And
yes,
that's
you do.
Why people... And that's why I get paid to speak. I get like 4 or 5, 6 speaking engagements a year. I'm with a couple of different companies. And, I consider myself very fortunate.
You are.
I was unfortunate in the fact that I never had a group to subsidize me on my training full time. But by the same token, I think life has been pretty good to me. Some things just fall into place. Hey, I go for the Golden Glove. I win a Golden Glove. I turn pro. I win a New Jersey championship. I get a shot finally after 12 years of fighting against the world champion, supposed to be Foreman, but he gets beat, and I wind up fighting the greatest, Muhammad Ali, which is worth 100 times more publicity than George Foreman. Even though George is a terrific fighter, Ali was the most famous. Stallone sees the fight in the movies, runs home and writes a script about a fighter like that named Rocky, and it was about me. I inspired the movie. Everything just falls into place, And it's lucky. Sometimes you have to be lucky in order to be good, they say, or in order to get a chance to be good. And
what did your mom say when after you got off the phone and she interrupted your Kojak? And was she at the fight?
No. My mother was sick in them days. She had broken her hip. She had
watching it?
Cancer in and out. No, she didn't.
But she knew you were fighting.
She knew I was fighting, and she was thrilled. As a matter of fact, as the story goes, after the title fight, my mother used to walk up and down Broadway in Bayonne and bump into people, you know, and say, oh, hi, how you doing? By the way, you know who I am? And the person would probably say something like, no, who really cares? And my mother would say, I'm Chuck Webner's mother. And the person would say, oh, Chuck Webner, really? The guy fought Ali? Would you like a picture of him signed? Nah, not really. I'm going to get you a picture signed. She'd come home at least once or twice a month. She'd come home with two or three names. I was on Broadway. This guy stopped me. Would love to have. I said, Mom, you're not bulldozing people into taking my pictures.
Typical mom, right?
Yeah, that's typical.
She's proud.
But, you know, things just kept steamrolling. Then the movie Rocky. And I used to go down to shore and they'd play the theme from Rocky or talk about it. And luckily, I fought Muhammad Ali, who is luckily still alive.
Yeah.
I hope he lives forever because I love the guy. He's terrific. And by the way, when I gave him the card, he reached up and gave me a kiss. He hugged me, you know, because, and his wife Lonnie was standing there because when I gave him the card, she's seen this card 20 times. I had different colors of it. I want to give you one of my new cards, you know. She'd smile because she knew what was coming. And he took the card in Las Vegas and he looks at the back of the card and he says, I thought I told you I don't like this picture.
Yeah.
Couple of fights. Ali really shouldn't have, you know.
Be boxing. I mean, the fight against Holmes shouldn't have happened.
Yeah, I don't
and
watch
then Trevor Burbick shouldn't have ever happened.
He shouldn't even be fighting then. He just didn't have, you know, in the first 25 fights of his career, he was undefeated.
Yeah.
And he lost to 4 years for refusal of induction, which unfortunately is what his people want him to do to prove a point. And, you know, that took maybe the best 4 years of his career away from him.
It did.
You know what I mean? And when he came back, he was still great enough to win back the title twice. But we lost 4 great years from one of the greatest fighters that ever lived. You know, he was untouchable.
If you could, Chuck, do it all over again, start from an age and go from there, what age would you start from and what would you do different to end up today?
I would start earlier, naturally. I like playing basketball. I would have probably started maybe in my late teens or early 20s, instead of waiting until 25 when I fought in the Golden Globe. But I also would have tried to get a group or a syndicate to back me, to subsidize me, to let me train full time.
Absolutely.
Because I never had that, you know, I can't tell you how many times I went to the gym at night to train and I had nothing. I was exhausted from working all day and I was working midnight some of that time, 12 to 8. And so I used to train, go home, grab a quick bite to eat, lay down.
So you didn't get proper sleep, you didn't get proper digestion, you didn't get proper rest.
No, it was tough, but I stuck to it. It was only one time in my whole career after the Liston fight. I was in shock. I had taken 72 stitches, he broke my nose, my left cheekbone, and Dr. Sikowski came to the house twice, and he told my wife, at that time I was with, my wife's name is Phyllis, my second wife, and he says, ice him down, because I was running a fever for 2 days. And he iced me down, and I was considering quitting. I said, you know, I don't know if I can take this kind of a beating again. I got to do one of two things. I either got to quit or I got to learn to duck.
So after all this, champ, it's interesting. Thank you for the belts and showing us, giving us the time, going through your life. At the end of the day, are you proud of what you've done?
I'm very proud.
Good for you.
Yeah, I'm very proud of what I've accomplished, and you know, it's I'm where I am today, and this may sound a little corny, but I owe that all to my wife, because you know, I got jammed up and I did a little time, and when I came home I was still running, and then I met Linda, and you know, that was the end of it. She said, my way or the highway.
Yeah.
I'd rather have it her way.
Well, your ability to change so quickly, right, at later on in your life was really monumental in so many ways. So, champ, I'm really honored to be here with you today, and I'm very happy that you had the time to share with me and the Waltham Channel. So I want to say thank you very much. We can certainly have dinner sometime. I'd love to take you out. I'd love to take you and your wife out.
Well, you know what it is? I have a million stories. You know,
like, I know you do.
This guy's doing a book on me. Mike Kunda sat here one night, just a couple weekends ago, and spent 5 hours going over stories, and it's been a great life.
Yeah.
And part of it is doing stuff with, you know, guys like you and Mike. You know,
wow. Well.
You guys are so nice. You drove all the way in. You took your time, and I hope everything works out.
Well, thank you. Well, you were very kind to return my phone calls, and it was really nice. I really appreciate it, and I'd like to be in touch with you, too. You're a special guy.
No problem.
Thank you. Thank you very much.